So feminism is thus not about individual men and women, but about understanding the ways in which men and women are produced and inserted into patriarchies that differ according to time and place. Again, to be a feminist is to understand that different identities located hierarchically as dominant or subordinate are produced at different times and in different spaces, but also to be aware particularly of the processes of gendering. Now, these are passages that I have quoted from Seeing Like a Feminist by Professor Menon. Critical feminist theory so lucidly explained, noted historian Tanika Sarkar correctly points out in her assessment of the book. Now, this book was published in 2012. The text and the author require no introduction, yet protocol demands that we introduce her. Professor Nivedita Menon is professor at the Center for Comparative Politics and Political Theory, Jawaharlal Nehru University. Apart from Seeing Like a Feminist, which was published in 2012, she has, to her credit, several research papers in Indian and international journals, and books such as Recovering Subversion, Feminist Politics Beyond the Law, which was published in 2004, Power and Contestation, India After 1989, edited with Aditya Nigam and published in 2007, two edited volumes called Gender and Politics in India, which was published in 1999, and Sexualities, published in 2007, and Critical Studies in Politics, Exploring Sites, Selves, Power, co-edited with Aditya Nigam and Sanjay Palshikar, and published in 2013. Professor Menon is a regular contributor to Kafila Online, of which she is one of the founders. Dr. Menon has also translated fiction and non-fiction from Hindi and Malayalam into English and from Malayalam into Hindi, and was the recipient of the A.K. Ramanujan Award for Translation instituted by Katha. Dr. Menon's talk today is titled Universal Basic Income and Land Rights for Women, an Anti-Capitalist Critic. She would be arguing that the growing approval for cash income grants in India and the grant of individual land rights for women are essentially about inclusion into the capitalist framework, and therefore we must question if such inclusion is a positive development. With this, I once again extend a warm welcome to Professor Nivedita Menon. Thank you so much, ma'am, for accepting our invitation, and a warm welcome to the audience. And now I request her to address.
Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me to Gandhinagar, to IIT Gandhinagar. I've been here to the old campus on another occasion. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to share with you some new work that I'm doing, and the abstract of which Madhumita has already shared with you, which basically has to do, the argument is basically that these appear on the face of it to be extremely progressive and even socialist demands. Individual land rights for women and a universal basic income for every citizen. These are, so UBI is something that has been proposed in many parts of the world, also in India, and individual land rights for women. What can possibly be wrong with that? What kind of a critique can a feminist make of that? So as Madhumita indicated, I argue that all of these are part of a larger project of building capitalism. And that's the argument that I'm going to make today. And I will largely read from this paper that I have. So for some time now, the argument for cash income grants has been made in India by broadly left-wing as well as neoliberal economists. So this is the other interesting thing, that UBI is something that is proposed by both left-wing as well as, in that sense, economically right-wing neoliberal economists. So I just want to make a quick distinction before proceeding, that there is one kind of argument for something called universal basic income, where every citizen gets a basic income for life. And there's something else called basic income grants. That's another proposal, BIG, big, I'll just say quickly. So UBI refers to proposals for minimum cash incomes provided to every citizen or resident of a country. And BIG refers to targeted income grants to the most vulnerable sections of the population. So there are two kinds of proposals. Both of these are about basically cash transfers, okay? Such proposals come from economists of both left and right and take somewhat different forms, therefore. So let's first look at neoliberal arguments for UBI BIG. Neoliberal economist Surjit S. Bhalla wrote supporting the idea of a state-provided basic income targeting the bottom 50% of the population. So this was in 2017, is one of his well-known articles, but he has been behind it for a while. The proposal positively counterposed direct transfer of a minimum cash income to individual bank accounts against, so this was meant to replace, poverty alleviation schemes such as the public distribution scheme, which is the ration PDS, the ration scheme, the national rural employment guarantee scheme, MNREGA. So the argument is that these kinds of schemes, poverty alleviation schemes, are riddled with corruption, and only a small fraction of food or wages intended for the poor actually reach them. On the other hand, a guaranteed minimum income to all population, adult, worker, the entire population, would be, according to Bhalla, an efficient redistribution of income. Bhalla suggested sources for the government to draw the resources for this policy, partly by scrapping PDS, the ration scheme, and MNREGA, and partly from the increased personal income tax collection he expected annually to result from the demonetization policy. So this was in 2017. Demonetization had just taken place, and he's arguing in a newspaper article that this will also yield income to the government. As it happens, that demonetization did not yield any income to the government. There's data to show that. But at that point, he expected that that would be one of the sources of income. The other source of income is to scrap all poverty alleviation programs. So within a month, as we know, 80% of the banned currency had re-entered the banking system. Thus, so it didn't work. The demonetization increasing the government's income didn't work, but he expected it to. Now, from this position, Surjit Bhalla's kind of neoliberal position, the argument is not for universal basic income, but for targeted basic income grants, that is limited cash transfers to those identified as the poorest. So you have, for example, the Economic Survey of 2017 also making a strong case for UBI as a radical measure to alleviate poverty. At that point, the chief advisor in 2017 in the finance ministry, Arvind Subramaniam, said it was not for immediate implementation, but the time had come to consider it seriously. And the cost of it would have to be met by dismantling existing welfare schemes. So this is a characteristic neoliberal position which promotes BIG or UBI by dismantling other welfare schemes. Now, a prerequisite to implementing UBI that the Economic Survey said is JAM, JAM, which is Jan Dhan accounts, Aadhaar, and mobile. So what are these three things? Of course, the Jan Dhan Yojana was set up in 2014 as a financial inclusion scheme under which 15 million bank accounts were opened with no minimum balance in order to provide universal and clear access to banking facilities. The Aadhaar card or UID is the unique identification biometric system which has de facto become necessary to access government benefits. And mobile phone coverage is essential for mobile banking, as otherwise innumerable physical branches of banks would have to be opened. So JAM is a prerequisite for BIG, which will replace welfare schemes. This is the standard, this is the neoliberal argument for BIG or UBI. Now, there's a long history of conservative and libertarian arguments for guaranteed or universal basic income arising from the idea that it reduces government intervention in social welfare schemes. So Milton Friedman in 1962 in Capitalism and Freedom had proposed a guaranteed income, which he termed as a negative income tax, arguing for the following benefits: that it would lead to a reduction of government bureaucracy, efficiency of free markets in which people vote with cash, as it were, and enabling people vote with cash, meaning because they'll vote for the cash that they're receiving. So this is a libertarian argument, and it is produced as if it is about state withdrawal, as if it is about less government intervention. If you just send cash to people into their accounts, the government does not have to intervene the way it does for welfare schemes like a public distribution system or rural employment guarantee, right? Or any employment guarantee for that matter. So it's notice that this is produced as a way for the state to step back. This is part of the neoliberal ideology. We'll see how much the state steps back, but So it reduced, so he said all these things. And similarly, Friedrich Hayek also in 1981, libertarian philosopher, supported the idea that the state should ensure a minimum income for everyone in a society in which state interference would then be minimal and the twin pillars of free market and private property would be protected. So this is a, so it's an old neoliberal argument, and it's been around for a while, and it's now in India taking more and more clearer shape. Now, one of the kinds of critiques of the targeted basic income grants, the policy of, the idea of targeted basic income grants, has been made on the grounds of its implementability. So you can imagine the range of arguments which say mobile networking won't work, or the technology required is not adequately tested, and so on. And then, of course, there's the well-documented fraud in Aadhaar cards. So there's one kind of argument against BIG in India, so I'm come back to India, which says it's simply not implementable. But we need to, so that's the neoliberal argument and one kind of critique of the neoliberal argument. But we need to now take on another substantive critique of BIG from a broadly left-wing position that supports UBI. Okay, so we've understood the difference between BIG and UBI. Universal versus targeted. So there's a substantive left-wing critique of BIG and a left-wing proposal for UBI, which also now, so now we're going to look at left-wing arguments for UBI. One of the very well-known theorists on this position is Guy Standing, a labor economist who wrote The Precariat. So this term that is now circulating so much, the precariat, comes from Standing's work. He wrote a book called The Precariat, The New Dangerous Class. And he's one of the key proponents of the UBI from the left. Standing's conception of the precariat includes large sections of the global population, the millions of people who have simply fallen out of the net of corporate global capital, which has rendered them superfluous to its needs. So that's the precariat. Global capital doesn't need labor anymore. So you have a large pool of people who simply are not needed by capital, and they are the precariat, from precarious, obviously. It's an interesting and useful term. So Standing has an India connection in the sense that in 2011, he had worked with Rinana Jabbala of SEWA, Self-Employed Women's Association, you know, in India and Gujarat, to launch two pilots to test the impact of basic income grants funded by UNICEF, and SEWA was the coordinator. And Standing supported basic income grants. But interestingly, Standing and Jabbala don't seem to have the same, they don't seem to go in the same direction, although they both support basic income grants. Because Rinana Jabbala is for basic income grants while dismantling welfare projects. So she, you know, she says there are, the same kind of thing. There are leakages, there's corruption, dismantle the welfare programs and implement BIG. Whereas Standing is opposed to the idea of direct income grants replacing subsidies and government schemes. So Jabbala and Standing do not share the same understanding of what BIG is meant to achieve. Because from the point of view of a Standing-inspired BIG, so Rinana Jabbala's falls more into the earlier kind of argument that I just explained. I mean, she's not, so this is where we're going to go with this argument that she's not for, she's not someone I would call a neoliberal theorist, but there is a way in which capitalism is taken for granted in these kinds of proposals. Now, Standing does not agree with replacing government schemes and policies with cash transfers, because there are, and the argument against the replacement from the left, that is replacing government schemes with cash transfers, that unconditional and direct cash transfers do not discriminate between varying situations, which might make cash benefits less helpful, and benefits in kind, such as food, maternity benefits, schooling, healthcare, guaranteed employments, etc., are more crucial for the poor. Another major issue with UBI replacing existing PDS is that when there is, let's say, drought or famine or crop loss or extreme inflation, natural disasters, etc., in-kind benefits are far more effective than meager cash transfers. So this is the broad left-wing argument which Standing represents for big in addition to existing welfare schemes. So in we have in India, for example, Jean Drez, Ritika Khera, they have worked together. They're both, of course, economists whom you must be familiar with. And they agree with Guy Standing that universal basic income grants are desirable, but not at the cost of existing social benefits for the reasons that I just explained. Jean Drez sees the apparent consensus on UBI on the right and left as masking deep differences. For the left, according to him, UBI is part of a comprehensive social security. So for him, UBI should be part of a comprehensive social security system that would also include universal healthcare, free education, good public services, some transfers to be in kind. For the right, as we have seen, UBI is to accompany deep cuts in other social welfare programs. Now, Drez, Khera, and some other left proponents of income grants seem to see these at best as limited measures within the limitations of the current political economy. But they are simply saying, okay, this is the economy, we have to work within it. These are limited ways of alleviating poverty. But there are also stronger left arguments for UBI. And here is where I'm suggesting that the strong arguments for UBI from the left share one thing with the neoliberal arguments that they criticize, which is that they both assume the omnipresence and inescapability of capitalism. This is actually quite there is a left perspective which assumes the inevitability and omnipresence and inescapability of capitalism. So let's look at what it means to see UBI. What do I mean when I say UBI remains, both left and right wing perspectives, remain within a capitalist horizon? So let's discuss in more detail Guy Standing's argument for UBI, which is the best illustration of this. Based on the understanding that a large proportion of the world's population has become dispensable for capital, more jobs is simply not the answer. This is Standing's argument. So the precariat is a class in the making, but unless it becomes a class for itself, that is, unless it organizes, it has agency, the anger and anxiety that lie at its heart could lead to, as Standing puts it, a politics of inferno, of hell. Standing traces the first stirrings of the global precariat to May Day 2001 in Europe, where hundreds of thousands of mostly young people marched to demand free migration and a universal basic income, demands that had little to do with traditional unionism. Standing's argument is that globalization, technological change, and government policies have created a world in which the income distribution system of the 20th century has broken down, will not come back, and real wages will continue to stagnate and fall. Technology has not destroyed work per se. It's just that the precariat does more and more work, most of which is now unrecorded, unrecognized, and unremunerated. Now, the precariat is thus, in his understanding, both victim and hero, for its politics is a politics of defiance. But Standing also believes that this new precariat may well be the basis of the right-wing populist shift across the globe. So he says they're becoming a new dangerous class, I'm quoting him. They are prone to listen to ugly voices and to use their votes and money to give those voices a political platform of increasing influence, unquote. So the UBI, from his perspective, is meant to give people the basic income security, which would take them away from this dangerous direction and make them work harder and more productively, not work less. So Standing's rationale for the UBI thus is predicated on the changed requirements of capital that render redundant large sections of populations globally, but it is also justified on the grounds that without such security, the precariat is dangerous, prone to be drawn to irrational, he uses this word, right-wing mobilization. And so neoliberalism needs to redistribute some of its super profits if this precariat is to work more productively and not push society towards a politics of inferno. So obviously, thus, it's being assumed that capitalism is inescapable and omnipresent. There is another very well-known left-wing proponent of UBI, who is Kathy Weeks, who ties in the idea of UBI with a critique of work itself, which she argues both on the right and left has been culturally overvalued. Why is work seen as something so wonderful? And why should, so it's, she's against work as such, okay? So she's making an interesting philosophical argument that the valorization of work and the over-celebration of work is very convenient for the capitalist economy, but people don't need to keep working in that way. That there are, so what her, so she draws on Marxist feminist literature on social reproduction, and she develops the idea of social reproduction as that entire kind of the social, cultural, and subjective infrastructures depend. Just so she's talking of, by social reproduction, she's talking about let's say to polarize it for the purposes of understanding public work versus family. Okay, so family meaning all the structures, I'm using it as a label for all the structures that are outside the public domain of work. So what she's saying is that maintaining the two separate spheres of waged work and unwaged social reproduction becomes conceptually impossible because both work and family have failed as inclusive and sustainable social forms. So why she promotes the basic income is basic income or UBI is a way to open conversations about what counts as work, because as you know, domestic work doesn't count as work, for the economy, for the census, etc. What counts as work, about the value of different kinds of work, and also about what else besides work we might want to do with our time, what other models of care, creativity, and cooperation we might want to build. So while existing welfare measures envisage the reintegration of beneficiaries into the labor market, BIG assumes a basic income to take into account the fact that most people will not ever get work or the opportunity to labor. And this, from Kathy Week's point of view, could be a good thing. So she's also supporting UBI or BIG. And she's saying, why valorize work? Who are you working for? What is this work that everybody must keep doing? And if you think back for a moment, I don't have time to go into it. If you think back about the historical moment when capitalism replaces in many parts of the world and unevenly, I'll come to that, when it replaces non-capitalist forms of life, one of the key things it has to do is discipline the population to learn to work and to feel guilty when you don't work and to be criminalized when you don't work. Loafer is actually, to loaf is actually one of the penal code things. Why are you loafing about? Why are you hanging around? Why are you, what is that other word? Loitering. So these were actually in England, Marx has written, if you read chapters 26 to 28 of Capital Volume 1, he gives you all the laws by which people had to be punished for simply not part, because you, everybody has to be available as cheap wage labor for the factories, and they've been thrown off their land, they can no longer farm. And you need to have everybody ready to work so that wages can be kept low. So what do you think Australia is populated with? You know, those ships of convicts that used to go. What are they convicted for? Were they, how were they criminals? Think about it. Look it up. What kinds of crimes did people who were packed into ships and sent to Australia commit? Mostly it was refusing to participate in the capitalist disciplinary model. So this is not a very crazy thing to say. Unfortunately, two centuries, three centuries down the line, it sounds like a crazy thing to say. But remember, we, within not living memory, but within living memory of humanity, the assumption that work is worship, right? Work is worship, is something that had to be deeply ingrained and naturalized so that the capitalist system could function. It's not that in non-capitalist forms, people aren't working, but that work is not acceptable. You cannot sell peanuts on the pavement. You cannot farm your land because that land has to go to an industry. So only certain kinds of work, that is working within the capitalist order, are acceptable. So when Kathy Weeks makes an argument against work, this is the kind of thing she's taking into account. So Standing and Weeks believe that new forms of solidarity. May I have a glass? I suspect I'll drop this all over myself. Thank you. While Standing and Weeks believed that new forms of solidarities and political utopias would emerge from the guarantee of a basic income, they do not address the fact that the very provision of this income, so this is my critique of their, I go with them up to a great extent. So they do envisage new forms of solidarities and utopia, but they do not address the fact that the very provision of this income, who provides this income? It would have to be provided by a state that shores up capitalism, because that income, that cash income has to come from somewhere, right? So I don't think they address the fact that the very provision of this income would require capitalism to carry on its ecologically devastating, in brackets, business as usual, and all wage receivers would have to be fully legible to the state. That is, if you're going to receive this income, the state has to see you. You have to be in the state system so that that money can go into your bank account. So it has been explicitly argued, and this argument, this critique that I'm making about standing and weeks is actually it's actually made quite explicitly on the left by those left-wing thinkers who believe that capitalism is inevitable, and that's quite a standard left-wing position as well. And it has been explicitly argued by some on the left that cash income grants like BIG or UBI would actually help to solve the crisis of falling demand in the capitalist economy. A crisis that can no longer be dealt with by the three methods that of stimulating demand that the capitalist economy has so far used, which is war, rise in wages, or higher levels of private debt. These are the three ways in which the capitalist economy has dealt with a crisis of stagnating demand. Okay? As technological progress enables growing production alongside vanishing jobs, only cash income grants can ensure that the global economy keeps ticking. By giving every citizen a monthly check, it's being argued by people like Streithorst, for example, by giving every citizen a monthly check, a basic income guarantee will be as fiscally stimulative as World War II without requiring the murder of millions. This is what Streithorst says. So with this last critique, we move towards an entirely different set of problems with UBI, which can be articulated from the point of view that does not assume capitalism to be inevitable, as both proponents and opponents of capitalism have tended to believe. Rather, it is worth recognizing that capitalism has to be built painfully. This, its own autobiography, or the way in which it presents itself, like Milton Friedman, Hayek, etc., is that the more capitalism works, the state just basically withdraws. Capitalism will do its own thing, the market will flood, everything will happen. But in fact, what we have to recognize that historically, capitalism has been always and still requires to be built painfully with heavy state intervention. Capitalism has to be built with heavy state intervention. And this fact has been recognized not by some kind of anarchist philosopher, but by one of the key proponents of capitalist development in the 20th century, who's still very, 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 very influential, Hernando de Soto. Hernando Soto is one of the most articulate and powerful proponents of capitalism of the late 20th to 21st century. And Hernando de Soto made it his life mission to understand, and I'm quoting him, someone who wants capitalism to succeed. He wants to understand, I quote, why capitalism triumphs in the West and fails everywhere else, and to redress the situation by getting states everywhere else to adopt policies that would enable capitalism to triumph. So at least here we have an honest argument. I think capitalism is great, states should push it. It's better to me, it seems to me more honest than the argument which says, I think capitalism is great, and when states withdraw, capitalism will just grow. Because you're then masking the ways in which the state is intervening at every step to build capitalism. So at least with Hernando de Soto, you get the agenda up front on the table right there. That in order for capitalism to work, the states have to intervene. What are the policies that should be developed? So what I'm going to do now, so we've talked about UBI, and I've also mentioned land rights for women. So let me now move to understanding the state-led support in India, because now there is a consensus across the board in terms of policy that women should have individual land rights. So just as I showed that something like targeted or universal income grants, which sounds like something that will help the poor, you can see what the context is. Now we're going to do the same thing with the agenda of land rights for women, which is being promoted across the board. So it seems to me that individual land rights for women is part of, thank you so much, is part of the capitalist agenda. And I'm just going to look at that very quickly. Bringing women into the ambit of individual property rights has long been one of the key issues in feminist practice and scholarship. But what happens to the feminist understanding of land rights for women in the face of large-scale land acquisitions for corporate globalization? Because now land acquisition is no longer for big development projects like dams. Now land acquisition by the state, when we say land acquisition, we're referring to land being taken over by the state. It's for corporate globalization. It's for private companies. So what happens to the feminist understanding of land rights for women in the face of large-scale land acquisitions for corporate globalization? Because the only real challenge to capitalist ambitions is posed by collective ownership of land and strong assertions of the commons. What does this recognition mean for feminist campaigns for individual rights for women, of which many of us who have been in the women's movement for a long time, we've actually supported land rights for women. But at this moment, several kinds of political movements and several strands of scholarship from the end of the 20th century onwards, for about three decades or so, are coming together to alert us to a need for a shift in feminist perspective on land rights for women. Let's begin with what we learn from struggles against the accelerated and large-scale land acquisitions by the state for use by private corporations. Activists in these movements and scholars engaged in understanding land relations are increasingly coming to the recognition that the Indian state is now very amenable to joint title deeds, that is for, which has been the main demand of the women's movement for decades, that is joint title deeds for husband and wife to land, to family land. However, as Smita Gupta argues, so it's called a patta, this land deed is called a patta. Smita Gupta argues that joint pattas are important, they're important, but the sole preoccupation with them is a problem thrust upon us by international agencies with a neoliberal agenda. Now, this is a left-wing feminist economist saying this, that joint pattas, for which we fought for decades, and it was seen as an indicator of how progressive land movements were, Tebhaga, for example, fought for joint pattas. But what she's now saying is that this is something this is actually being pushed on us, on people, on movements and state, Indian state, and by, et cetera, by international agencies. The women's movement, Gupta says, must focus far more on dispossession, land use change, lack of access to the commons, and the depletion or degradation of the commons. Small individual plots in a context of rising and widespread agrarian distress will in fact increase women's drudgery, Gupta believes, and she believes that collective farming, and she's linked to movements, that collective farming with state support is one of the ways forward. Individual land rights, whether to men only or also to women, restrict farmers to family plots by giving them formal title deeds, even joint pattas, while the state takes control of common and public lands. So what it means is that you're changing the character of collective and public lands, making them state-owned, and but it's being done within the discourse of land rights for women. So you give a husband and wife rights to their little family plot, but commons and collective land are taken over by the state. So what happens is that enclosures, evictions, and land use policies are all state strategies for taking over common and public lands. And of course, the deeds are no magic potion against land acquisition. Rather, individual title deeds facilitate land acquisitions by the state. Furthermore, because you're talking then to two people, not to a community, not to a gram panchayat. You don't have to get the whole gram panchayat. And as you know, I will unfortunately not be able to go into all that here, but as you know, the Forest Rights Act is being really transformed by making gram panchayats, by removing the rights for gram panchayats to actually be able to stop any kind of. Interestingly, after August 5th, the abrogation of Article 370, one key policy change in the former state of J&K is 170 projects have been cleared, which needed green clearance. But green clearance has been also abrogated along with 170 projects for forest clearance of the forests of J&K have been cleared. So I'm not saying anything else, but think about how quickly that was carried out under the circumstances we know that J&K is in. So this is part of state policy and not necessarily this government. So I'm talking about state policy too. And so it's not as if the UPA was running any less, especially UPA 2 was equally neoliberal. So this is part of the a state agenda and an international neoliberal agenda. So through enclosures, evictions, and land use policies, the state takes over common and public lands. Individual title deeds, as I said, facilitate land acquisitions by the state, and it has long been understood in the context of land reforms that joint patta, in effect, what does joint patta do? It sidelines the quest of land distribution and is therefore not a radical agenda. So, for example, Mercia Andrews, land rights activist from South Africa, she puts it like this, that no effective land struggle is possible without breaking up the patriarchal nuclear family. You can't think about land struggle with separate patriarchal nuclear families. Roma, an activist with All India Union of Forest Working People, is opposed to the patta as such. So this is from the forest context. One is agricultural land, but this is now from the point of view of forests. So she believes that the patta looks at land use and ownership exclusively through the prism of the family. And in her experience, she says only collective ownership can fracture patriarchy. And her organization works with movements that collectively cultivate land. Such a movement would be a movement of the landless. This brings up the question of caste. Because middle and upper peasantry who own land do not include, let's say, Dalits who don't own land. So she actually would focus on movements of the landless. So in this understanding, there's a contradiction between the interests of peasants and the interests of landless, largely Dalits who use common lands. In her understanding then, an alliance is required of marginal farmers and landless, and this would address the caste divide as well. Common lands that embody layers of customary use rights. So we must recognize use rights, usufructuary rights, as opposed to outright ownership. So the idea of use rights, which is actually something that this generation, millennials, understand from other contexts, sharing of music, et cetera, which are being attacked by piracy laws, sharing. So this is about, so when you say use rights, it's when you have a book and you photocopy it and then you share it, then it's use rights. You're not necessarily going to ask for the book back. So this is just an example to explain what use rights would mean, as opposed to outright ownership, which is a standard capitalist thing that I own this, I can sell it. That idea had also to be introduced by capitalism, by colonialism in India, that land is alienable, and by primitive accumulation in the West. Common lands that embody layers of customary usufruct rights are the biggest challenge to market relations, and prime among such lands are forests. It is in this context that land occupation movements by castes and tribes, traditionally excluded from agriculture, must be viewed and understood. For example, the occupation of Muthanga forest lands in Kerala by Adivasis under C.K. Janu, if you remember that movement in 2003, they were violently evacuated. So the so-called occupation of lands by the poor is in fact a reoccupation of common lands, which were turned into state-owned land overnight. So they're reasserting rights over spaces that were and they were turned into state-owned land overnight through colonial legislations, such as the Indian Forest Acts of 1878 and 1927, but equally fiercely enforced by the post-independence Indian state as well. So globally, the trend is towards the legitimization of states. The trend is towards the legitimization by states and World Bank institutions of property titles for the poor and for women, even as these states engage in large-scale land acquisition in the interests of extractive capital. So if you want to think of a contradiction, think of this. The contradiction is not why, it's also a contradiction why the left and the feminists are participating in this, but it's an unwitting participation. The real interesting contradiction, and this is what feminists and the left need to be asking, is why are states which engage in large-scale land acquisition in the interest of extractive capital talking about simultaneously individual property rights for the poor, for slum owners, for women? What's going on there? So clearly there's some way in which what we thought was a left progressive agenda is actually something that, so what do we need to do about that? I've already indicated we need to be moving towards collective rights and reassertion of commons as opposed to individual private rights. Now, there are three kinds of access to land rights in India, but I will only
address one here, obviously, because we don't want to sit here for 2 weeks. So there are three kinds of access to land rights in India. One is through religious personal laws to agricultural land, then through forest acts to forests, and through customary laws to agricultural and forest lands occupied by tribal people. So there are these three sets of legal, but I will only discuss the personal laws, the religious personal laws. I'm calling it religious, but that's a complicated story. Let me see if I can address some of that. So, but the fact is that access to agricultural land is governed by the Hindu personal law, by the Muslim personal law, by the Christian personal law. So religious is not a bad short form to use. But it's important to keep in mind that none of these laws, they're called personal laws and they're called customary laws, but they are not in any pure sense traditional or indigenous. So let me just put it out here that possibly you're a social sciences bunch of students and mostly students, but I'm sure you're all aware that there is no such thing as untouched tradition. So I don't have to go into that. Tradition is continuously produced and reproduced. So similarly, neither personal laws nor customary laws are in any pure sense traditional or indigenous. A large body of scholarship has shown that even up to the 18th century across India, there was a considerable range of authorities offering different types of justice and a multiplicity of scriptural and customary sources of right. The colonial state's efforts to consolidate a body of Hindu and Islamic law to vindicate its claim to be ruling on the basis of the laws and customs of the people, in fact, resulted in a body of jurisprudence that modified both scriptures and custom in keeping with official objectives whenever necessary. There's a large body of scholarship on this. I won't go into this. Similarly, regarding the customary laws of tribal people of Northeast and Central India, while the British claimed to leave them to be governed by their customary practices, in fact, traditional communities were reshaped as viable revenue-generating areas. And colonial village heads such as Gaon Bura were established parallel to traditional chieftains. So colonial control of the Northeast was important for strategic reasons, and of course, Central India. So these are the two tribal areas were rich in minerals. So it's impossible today, therefore, to excavate any purely indigenous practice or purely traditional practice. It's also important to note the continuity of policy between the colonial and post-independence Indian state, which is not to say there are no differences. We are aware of the differences, but it's also important to note the continuity. So let me very quickly look at women's rights to land in personal laws. Feminist scholars, so that's all I'm going to look at today, not forests, not customary laws and tribals, only women's rights to land through religious personal laws. Now, feminist scholars like Beena Agarwal have argued for decades now for women's independent rights in land on grounds of welfare, efficiency, equality, and empowerment. She has pointed out that it has been easier to push the welfare and efficiency arguments with state planners than equality and empowerment of women. So if you push women's rights for women on, so this is in the late 90s when she's writing, in the mid-90s, she said that it's easier to say welfare and efficiency is good for women to have rights for that reason than if you say equality and empowerment of women, because that sounds dangerous and destabilizing. So the former are more easily understood within a poverty alleviation framework, she suggests, while the latter run counter to deep-rooted notions of appropriate gender relations shared by many men who make and implement policy, for whom more equal gender relations appear as threatening to existing family and kinship structures. Certainly nothing leads us to think. So this is what Beena Agarwal writing in the early 90s. Now, nothing should lead any of us to think that these attitudes have changed, these attitudes of suspicion towards women having any. On the contrary, policymakers continue to express the most appallingly sexist and misogynist opinions quite freely. We know that for many years now. And yet in 2005, the amendment to the Hindu Succession Act of 1956, which gave women rights to ancestral property, was passed unanimously in both houses of Indian Parliament, first in the upper house Rajya Sabha and then in the Lok Sabha the same year. Several states had already passed such legislation between 1986 and 1994, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka and Maharashtra, and Kerala abolished the joint family altogether in 1975. So so the states had done it at different levels, and the Hindu Succession Amendment Act of 2005 established gender equality on agricultural land and in joint co-passory, joint family property. And some like feminists like Beena Agarwal saw this as a landmark, and it is a landmark, but what is fascinating, really the real question we need to ask is, how is it that policymakers with such incredibly patriarchal and misogynist mindsets, how is it that they pass this law? So this is intriguing. So I looked at the debates in Parliament at 2000, it's available online. So I went to look at the debate on the Amendment Act of 2005. Remember this year, 2005, something happens else happens in 2005. You might understand why this happens in a minute. But if you look at the debate on the Hindu Succession Act Amendment Bill in Lok Sabha, it's intriguing. Because on the one hand, there are many MPs who had clearly not even read the proposed amendments with any care. They made mistaken claims and demands, but they enthusiastically supported the bill. So they stand up. So if you look at, they're standing up, they're supporting the bill, and they're saying, but we also need X, which is already in the amendment. We also need Y, that's also already in the amendment. So you've not read the amendment with any care, but you're standing up and you are saying, yes, great, women should have equal rights to property. So that's one kind of support. But several MPs had very negative responses to the bill. And the negative responses included very standard arguments about what will happen to families if women have access to property, it will break up the family, women will become too independent, etc., etc. So you have huge support, or rather enthusiastic support from one kind of MP who has not read the amendment carefully. Another lot they argue against the bill on very typical misogynist patriarchal grounds, despite and across party lines. It's not as if there's one party. Across party lines, you have these kinds of intriguing responses, and yet it was unanimously passed in the Lok Sabha. Finally, after the debate takes place, when you're asked, do you vote? How do you vote? Everybody votes for it. Earlier, we said it was also unanimously passed in the Rajya Sabha. Now, I didn't look at the debates. I just came across this news item which said, so there was not much of a debate in the Rajya Sabha because the news report said only one male member, the rest were women, participated in the discussion that came at the fag end of the day. Some of the members pointed to the low attendance in the house during the debate. This is a debate on individual rights to women in co-pastory ancestral land, and nobody bothers to be present in the Rajya Sabha, and it is unanimously passed. Only one man was present. And the Minister for Law at that time, H.R. Bharadwaj, expressed happiness at the unequivocal support given to the bill by the opposition. At that time, the opposition was the NDA and the UPA was in power. So it was passed. Now, the mystery about this might become clearer in a little bit. I'll come to that. Why? What happened in 2005 that despite deep-seated misogynist and patriarchal views on the part of MPs, on the one hand, and on the other hand, complete apparently lack of interest, it gets unanimously passed. So from 2005, Hindu women have individual rights to property. It's another matter that many women may not exert these rights. Family pressures still operate. They don't want to break up the family. It's true. They may not exert these rights, but these rights exist. Now, as far as Muslims and Christians are concerned, the Shariat Act of 1937 that governs Muslims permits agricultural land rights to be governed by custom, as a result of which in many states, Muslim women are excluded from ownership of land. And there has been an ongoing campaign to end this discrimination along the lines of the 2005 amendment of the Hindu Succession Act. Christians and Parsis are governed now by the Indian Succession Act, which permits ownership rights for ancestral property to women. But our concern in this paper goes beyond asking whether women have equal rights to land to ask why women's individual rights to land is so centrally on the agenda of the Indian state, not any particular government, but the Indian state, and what the transformation is that is being brought about in the name of equal rights for women. So for this, I need to take about 5 minutes to seek some answers from about a century ago. Because we have to look at the history of the emergence of these laws very quickly, I promise. So what happens under colonialism is that modern regimes of property are being produced. So some very interesting historical work started emerging in the first decade of this century, the 21st century, on Hindu law reform and codification in late colonial India. a process that has hitherto been debated in feminist scholarship exclusively in terms of enhancement or curtailing of women's rights to property, right? I mean, Hindu law reform is seen as something about women's rights to property. But in this context, the work of, for example, Ritu Birla, who published a book in 2009, Eleanor Newbegin, 2009 also, is enabling a reframing of this codification rather than seeing it as women's rights. I'm using Ritu Birla's phrase that this is the making of capitalist subjects. So there's some new interesting historical scholarship that looks at the transformations of the colonial period in terms of the making of capitalist subjects. So when you do that, when you look at the same developments through the prism of the making of capitalist subjects as opposed to women's rights, you see another picture emerge, because when you look through one lens, you see one picture. When you look through another lens, you see another picture. And I am focusing on Hindu law largely, because through the law reforms of the 1860s, colonial officials both created and formalized personal laws, the effect of which was different on Muslim and Hindu personal law, as Eleanor Newbegin demonstrates. Quranic Shariat law was presented as clear-cut and easily applied, under which Muslim families were considered to comprise of property-owning individuals, whereas the natural condition of a Hindu family was assumed to be joint. So the colonial government looks at the Muslim community as, and in fact this is the case, that they were property-owning individuals, but this idea of the Hindu undivided family, right? It's HUF, it's actually a tax category, it's a formal category, that is only among Hindus. So interestingly, now that there is this huge discourse over the in post-independence India that Muslim law is backward somehow and non-modern, and Hindu law has been reformed. In fact, at that time, it was Hindu laws that were required as considered as requiring reform to bring them into the modern world of individual rights to property, which already existed in the Muslim community under Islamic law. The impetus towards reform, argues Newbegin, came from conflicts between Hindu professional and mercantile elites on the one hand and agrarian elites on the other. One could say new and old in that sense, right? The new and emerging professional and mercantile elites and the agrarian elites on the other, putting pressure on the coparcenary system. The Mitakshara is one of the legal, there is the Abhaga system and the Mitakshara system. The Mitakshara is coparcenary, which is a joint. So it put pressure on the Mitakshara coparcenary and its system of joint intergenerational property ownership through which agrarian elites maintained their authority. While for Indian merchants competing with European capital, this focus on joint land rights and its effect of locking away capital in land is the way it's understood, was problematic. Now, as she points out, both groups are found in the same family sometimes, right? The younger generation is the mercantile, emerging mercantile elite, etc. And younger men gradually oppose joint family living and collective property ownership in the emerging Anglo-Hindu law. These developments cannot be seen independently of the longer process of turning land into a commodity, which began with the permanent settlement of 1793 and culminated in the Land Acquisition Act of 1894, the process through which what Ranjit Guha calls the rule of property was sought to be established over heterogeneous practices of land use and land relations. There were heterogeneous practices of land. There were matrilineal communities in the Northeast, in Kerala. From the colonial point of view, I did say earlier that one of the things of the UBI is that it makes you legible to the state. So this was a mess that the state, it was not legible to the colonial state. So the colonial state makes everything legible by instituting private property in land, as capitalism had done in Europe earlier. So the process through which the rule of property was established over heterogeneous practices of land use and land relations, thus creating what Sumit Sarkar calls a precise and definitive location of saleable property right. So this is a very old project. It's a very old, what's happening now is a very old project. So you can see why Hernando de Soto is so upset. We keep saying socialism failed and capitalism succeeded. The proponents of capitalism understand that capitalism is struggling to hold itself. So we should also note that this process was far from successfully completed by the end of colonial rule. For as Anjit Guha argues, the grafting of a capitalist vision of land rights to the Indian agrarian system without an understanding of the traditions on which it was based resulted in continuing forms of feudal land relations at independence. So then you have, so I can take another 10 minutes? Yes.
we started, I started about 10:40.
So the independent Indian state still needed to address the land question. And if you take you very quickly to the debate over the First Amendment to the Constitution in 1951, that's a fascinating debate. You'll find it again. I would suggest you just, there are three changes that came about through that amendment. I won't go into all of them. I'm interested in it. It restricted the freedom of expression. It introduced, it limited right to property. So that's what I'm going to look at now. So the right to agrarian property was, so this was one of the key changes that happened with the First Amendment to the Indian Constitution, by which the right to agrarian property, please note, was significantly limited by an amendment to Article 31, through which the individual's right to property was made subject to the state's right to acquire property to resolve what Nehru termed the land problem, which is basically land for industry, and but also land for big development projects like dams and so on. Government acquisition of land could no longer be challenged after this amendment, could no longer be challenged on grounds of inadequate compensation, and the ninth schedule was created in which land reform legislation was to be placed, because what was happening at that time was land reform legislation was being challenged in court and courts were holding up land reform legislation. So this amendment was meant to stop the courts from, because the courts were holding it up citing right to property. So this amendment put all land reform legislation into a schedule, the ninth schedule, and it protected it from judicial review. So this amendment shows the nation state in the process of establishing a capitalist economy through what has been called a passive revolution I won't go into that, but Sudipta Kaviraj uses this Gramscian idea to argue that this was an attempt to bring about a capitalist revolution without bringing about a revolution in on the ground, because if you think of capitalist transformations elsewhere, first few, these land relations had to be completely dismantled. But here you're doing it piecemeal. That's because that's a different historical moment. But what is interesting is that these reforms were not meant to weaken property rights as such. They were meant to weaken only rights to agrarian property, to landed property. In feudal estates. And in fact, the finance minister, T.T. Krishnamachari, in a later letter to Nehru during discussions on the Fourth Amendment in 1954, said very clearly, I'm quoting Krishnamachari, quoted by Austin, we have to move to the left on agricultural land, but moving left in industry will prevent expansion. So you can see what the Indian state is attempting to establish. So when you look at UBI and individual land rights for women today, it's part of this long process of trying to create capitalist subjects and to transform land relations in a capitalist direction, which is a long drawn out kind of project, which is still not in a sense complete. And we could, well, if I have 2 minutes at the end, I might be able to say why it's so difficult here, because you might want to think about why was it so easily done in Europe from the 16th to the 18th centuries. Capitalism was established, land relations were done, and why was it not possible here? So we might want to think about that. Then very soon what happens is through the Hindu Marriage Act of 55 and the Hindu Succession Act of 56, far-reaching changes were brought about. These changes are usually presented as reform of Hindu laws to give women equal rights to property, rights to divorce, and so on. But it has been convincingly demonstrated by feminist scholars that what in fact these legislations achieved was the codification of vast and heterogeneous practices of communities that were not Muslim, Parsi, Christian, because the definition of Hindu, which finally concretizes around the Hindu code bills of 1955 to 56, the definition of Hindu is simply those who are not Muslim, Christian, Parsi. Because there is no substantive content you can give to the definition of Hindu. So you might want to at some point take it as a challenge to think, can anybody arrive at just one thing that all Hindus can be defined by, and you will not find it. So the law, they finally gave up, and this is the legal definition of Hindu. That those who are not Hindu, Christian, Muslim, Parsi, or Christian. And what happens with the Hindu code bills is that it's a codification, bringing heterogeneous practices into conformity with what was assumed to be Indian and Hindu norm, which was actually North Indian upper caste practices. Just the other day, one of my colleagues from Jharkhand, she says I'm a tribal from Jharkhand. She said that she was talking to another colleague. So this is mid 21st century a mid-21st century university where people, presumably two faculty members are talking, where presumably there's some understanding. So she happened to say that in our marriage system, we don't have saptapadi, the five, seven steps, which is how. And he said, "Fir to aap Hindu nahi hai." Now the interesting thing is there are two responses to that. No, she could say, "Nahi, hum hain Hindu, but Hindu ke alag alag practices hote hain." But she could also say, "Sahi hai, hum nahi hai Hindu. Nahi hai hum Hindu. You have put us into the big basket called Hinduism, but in fact, there is we are not. We are a set of heterogeneous communities." So two answers were possible. She was only laughing, but I was thinking two answers were possible. She was just shocked that he could be so ignorant of marriage practices, not from some like marginal place, but right there in Jharkhand. Anyhow. So through these processes, we see how from so how the post-colonial state carries on the process of trying to bring about the capitalist subject. So here I want to take a minute to look at the opposing aims, the contradictory aims of the capitalist state and the patriarchal family, because there is a way in which feminist theory sometimes or often tends to assume that capitalist state and the patriarchal family are both functioning in the same way to restrict women. But you actually can see the contradiction between the two if you look at these new laws that are emerging. So I'm arguing that the personal laws on succession and property, such as the Hindu Succession Act, represent a point of conflict between the imperatives of the state and the imperatives of the family. The modern state requires legibility in order, that is, the modern state wants to be able to see every single. So you, Aadhaar, for example, is the ultimate legibility technology, right? The state can see you. I'm obviously, and I'm sure many of you are familiar, I'm obviously using the metaphor that James Scott uses, seeing like the state, but we can come to that if you like later. So I'm suggesting that these two represent a point of conflict between the imperatives of the state and the imperatives of the family. The modern state requires legibility in order to mobilize resources towards capitalist industrialization. That is, it must be able to see and recognize the forms of property in existence. Towards this end, the institution of individual rights to property is crucial. All forms of property must become completely alienable and transparent to the state. This development is essential for capitalist transformation of the economy. The family, on the other hand, has its own imperatives of controlling name, descent, and passing on of property, a project that is disrupted by individual property rights for women, or even for men. If you think about earlier, that's why the copartneries continue to exist. However, the desire to modernize and to set up such a regime of property rights is also present in sections of the community, as we saw, for example, with New Begin's argument about the same family having two kinds of elites. So then you have these debates between progressives and conservatives. Progressives want what the state wants. Conservatives resist the state. But it is in the light of this understanding that we must view the gradual granting of land rights to women under Hindu law all the way up to 2005, when both married and unmarried daughters were given rights to copartnery property as well. These changes are more than a simple triumph of a feminist perspective. This is my point. If we see this as some great landmark for feminist politics, we would miss out on the fact that they also represent the establishment basically of a capitalist regime of property for the Hindu community, at least in principle. At least in principle. Why I'm saying in principle is because, as I said, women often don't exert. They don't want to fight with their brothers, kind of a thing. But brothers are fighting with each other all the time, right? So property laws are, I mean, there are continuous property disputes which go on for generations between brothers and between fathers and sons. But often women, they haven't started anyway to do this. It's not in practice, but in principle, it establishes a capitalist regime of property, which basically makes land completely alienable by every separate individual owner. So it's no longer use rights, but I can take this and sell it, right? Now, in the current climate of widespread resistance to land acquisition, this is a considerable achievement for the state and for capitalist interests within the community, as it's always easier to pressurize or tempt individual owners rather than communities to sell land. So now, in conclusion, I'm going to not go into everything that I have left, but I do want to go back to the mystery of 2005. What happened in 2005 and why, when clearly the large majority of parliamentarians were either disinterested, that's peculiar, the disinterest also requires some explanation. Why is it that they don't care that unmarried daughters will get access, individual rights, unmarried even, let alone married, right? So we don't think anything drastic has changed. We don't see any great transformation in patriarchal mindsets, misogyny, sexism. Indian family is alive and thriving as a heterosexual patriarchal institution. So what kya in 2005? That distinct lack of enthusiasm but in or actual opposition, but ultimately when it comes to voting across the party lines, everybody. Now, this obviously suggests, and I haven't done the research for that, that there was some kind of party directive across the board for all parties' members to vote for this. Clearly, there was some directive. It may not have been a whip because a whip requires everyone to be present. And as we saw in Rajya Sabha, they were not present. But it was very clear they were meant to vote for this. Okay. So now what we find something happened in 2005, but let me just skip ahead a little bit to 2010. So in June 2010, a news report noted that our Peruvian economist, Hernando de Soto, who is hailed as the poor man's capitalist, he's like, this is something he wears with pride, had arrived in India to help the then UPA government to merge the informal economy in the slums of the country with the formal or the mainstream one. And when he was interviewed in this news report, he said he was actually invited by FICCI, a Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry. But he was invited by FICCI, but he met the Prime Minister, Manmohan Singh, he met the Union Minister for Housing, etc. It was one of the officials who spoke to the journalist said, and he was quoted as saying, De Soto's approach is essentially based on capitalist economic principles. Our government will try to meld them into our socialist objectives because socialism is still being talked about at that juncture. UPA 1 was still talking about 2010 is not UPA 1, sorry. Yeah. Wait. Yes, it's 2000, UPA 2. So socialism is still being talked about, but nevertheless, it's very clear that this is a capitalist plan. Now, the De Soto agenda has long been recognized by some scholars, particularly Timothy Mitchell, as a project of attempting to bring about capitalism globally through sustained state intervention. And Timothy Mitchell has done some very interesting work on De Soto, who basically believes, so De Soto does his research in five countries and says, look, a large amount of their wealth lies outside the formal economy. Bring them in. So formalizing, informal as something necessarily bad. But why do you think? Because it's not visible to the state. This is the only problem with informal. What is wrong with informal, if you ask yourselves? Why formalization across the board, left and right-wing economics, is about formalizing. And the only positive aspect of it appears to be that the state can see you. I don't see any argument against informalization as such. So he says this wealth lies outside the formal economy, it's trapped in forms that cannot enter the market. He describes it as dead capital and so on. And he then encourages basically property titling in slums. But all the evidence from India, Africa, and Latin America goes to show that individual rights to land is a strategy that achieves one objective. So this is over decades, this strategy has been followed in Africa and Latin America in particular, but also obviously in India, that individual rights to land is a strategy. We're not talking of property as such, please remember. I'm talking about right to land. Achieves nothing. What it achieves is the opening up of land for capitalist transformation, often via the state. De Soto's program was promoted powerfully by bodies like the UNDP High-Level Commission on Legal Empowerment of the Poor. What word in this can you think is bad? Legal empowerment of the poor, right? I mean, this is UNDP after all. And in fact, India's introduction to De Soto was not in 2010 with his first visit, because this high-level commission, which was co-chaired by the very, not very socialist, former US Secretary of State Madeleine Albright and Hernando De Soto, it was co-chaired. India was one of the founding members of the UNDP High-Level Commission on Legal Empowerment of the Poor, and this was set up in September 2005. Around the same time as the amendments to the Hindu Succession Act were being passed with such a puzzling lack of enthusiasm, but nevertheless unanimously by the Indian Parliament. So there's obviously an international neoliberal project to bring about, to implement De Soto's. De Soto is just a guy who runs an NGO. Remember that. He's just a think tank. He doesn't have any political, you know, he's not elected. He's not accountable to anybody. Okay. So finally, sorry, now I'll really only take a minute, I promise. From the perspective that this paper offers, all three, the state, the traditional religious community, and the customary community, are equally problematic from the point of view of equitable access to land for women, as well as other excluded castes and groups. A truly radical agenda would thus have to challenge all three factors simultaneously. One, state-led capitalist enclosures of the commons. So this has to be challenged. It's been called the new extractivism by some scholars. We have to challenge private individual land ownership. And thirdly, gendered and casted forms of exclusion from land use. This struggle would have to be waged in a context, we have to remember, of accelerated decline of agriculture in an era of rampant dispossession. So the link between, finally, De Soto's program of property titling and UBI Big is that both seek to bring all wealth into the formal economy where it can be available for capitalist speculation. UBI Big would replace social security schemes with cash, while property titling is meant to stimulate an economy of mortgage, and all of this is meant to enter the banking system. Thus, both proposals are either deliberately part of or unwittingly feed into this agenda of formalizing all wealth and savings and making them visible to capital for mobilization. In order to move beyond both, we need to reject the capitalist horizon altogether. And a very interesting work by J.K. Gibson Graham. So this, it's interesting. I don't know if some of you may be familiar with J.K. Gibson Graham, whose book is called The End of Capitalism as We Knew It. And J.K. Graham Gibson is actually two women, J. Gibson and K. Graham, but they write as one person. So they're feminists, and their insight, which I will only place on the table now, is that capitalism does not ever succeed in encompassing all of society. It is not a complete closed structure. Multiple non-capitalist practices exist alongside or outside it. This is what is bothering De Soto, that it's never able to encompass all of society. And what the state is supposed to do is make it impossible for these non-capitalist practices to survive in order to make capitalism work. So Gibson Graham argue for the need to destabilize the hegemony of capitalocentrism that produces the idea that capitalism is inescapable and omnipresent. So the goal probably would be then to be in solidarity with struggles of people to build and protect non-capitalist ways of life, collective rights to land and property of different sorts. All over the global south, such communities and pockets can be found, either actively resisting incorporation into the capitalist order or escaping it. In the global north, where capitalism has been established more extensively, the degrowth movement offers a way of rethinking our world. Some of you may be familiar with degrowth, which is about, they call it sustainable degrowth. It's a downscaling of production and consumption. Degrowth, I'm quoting from their website, proposes a shrinking of the economic system to leave more space for human cooperation and ecosystems. So finally, a truly transformative politics must move away from an individual-centered capitalist regime of property and learn from the experience of movements for digital commons, for intellectual property commons, as the paradigm for the future.